Ladies and gentlemen, hello and welcome back. We're in game number four here in the Summit 5 Chinese qualifiers. The Wings Gaming facing off against Vici Gaming Reborn. I gotta tell you, I'm super excited about this one. We saw some shenanigans, some craziness, game number three. The Wings Gaming kind of outdrafted themselves. They felt like they had to take a 10-minute break afterwards to recuperate, figure out what they wanted to run next. And it looks like Batrider is going to be their first pick, followed up by the Vengeful Spirit and the Life Steal. So the instant counters, this could be a little bit difficult.
I mean, Venge is pretty good against bats, but Lifesteal is not great against bats. In fact, it's probably the other way around. Bats one of the better heroes controlling a Lifestealer.
Right.
I think the last game, it was just Wings were like, there was a kind of mind game in the draft where VGR were like, okay, we'll give away the Ulk. Initially, game one, they planned to take the Ulk. Didn't work for them. So then they were like, we'll ban the Ulk. Game three, they decided to give away the Ulk. And Wings, because it's being given away so directly, they were like, we have to do something clever with our Ulk. Okay, we'll make it a support. Didn't work out at all. The interesting dynamic for this draft for me is, firstly, that Wings have banned out the Phoenix, which FY has been playing in most of the games. And secondly, that they have the bat. I mean, Wings play a very good bat, but in this series and in the previous time they played each other 2 days ago, Wings were the ones actually banning the bat most of the time. They were respecting VGR's bat more than VGR respecting their bat. So I found that quite interesting, because I would think of Wings as Batrider more, usually. I guess just because it's more of a novel bat. They're the ones that buy the drum very irregularly on the hero. But it is going to be a bat, finally, in a match between these teams. And also, no Phoenix, so FY having to do something different.
Yeah, and I like the response also. Well, not the response, but the thing that they're trying to combo with it. You've got the Witch Doctor getting taken. So as long as you get relatively good levels on these two heroes, it creates a really potent ganking squad where Lifestealer is not going to be able to get away from that Death Ward when it does eventually come out. Also going to be taking the Tidehunter out of the pool, as well as the Slark, and now a fourth ban here for Vici Gaming Reborn. I mean, you look at this lineup already from the start, and you can see that there are things that they're trying to do. Shut down either the safe lane or the mid lane hero, depending upon who it is and where they need to apply that pressure. But also, Vici Gaming Reborn, this is a hero that can fight very early in the Lifestealer, and then the natural steroid that you get with that minus armor coming from Vengeful Spirit.
Yep. It makes sense to ban the Slark. It matches up very nicely against the Lifestealer. It makes sense to ban the Tide. In similar veins to the Phoenix, like, remember last game, VGR started with the Phoenix and the Void, and it was like, okay, now we're just not going to lose team fights. And Wings are trying to make sure they don't get into that position again, where there's these like huge brutal AoE heroes that just make it impossible to win team fights, because that's never a position they want to be in. They're a team that always wants to be able to fight. And look at that, VGR banning the Treant Protector. It's that is a hero that I don't think has been banned against any team except for Wings in the last few months. But it is the second time I've seen it banned against them recently. It is a hero that they like to run and can be particularly brutal, helping out the Batrider early on in lane, especially where one of your supports is Vengeful Spirit. Zoning out and controlling that Batrider, not so easy. Obviously, with the Lifestealer, it could be the option for VGR to try and actually kill the bat, but if they're not killing the bats, to actually zone it out at the moment with the support they have, not very easy at all.
Yeah, and this right here also, a pretty nice ban, something that maybe people who aren't too familiar with the Chinese scene wouldn't recognize, but the Storm Spirit Lifestealer combo is something that we've seen a couple of different teams run, and it can be really potent if you're able to accelerate very rapidly and, you know, get the level 6 up on both of those heroes. You find kills that you wouldn't otherwise be able to make happen, so it makes a lot of sense taking that out of the pool. There still are other ways you can do it. We've seen I was going to say Beastmaster, but he's already obviously banned out, but also like a Nyx Assassin is another option. It's pretty great against the Batrider too, with the Spike Carapace being able to interrupt his movement, so that might be something that Vici Gaming Reborn look for.
Yep, there's still a lot of room available for direction in actually both of these drafts, which is kind of unusual for the series, by the way. This is like this series, we've known quite a lot about the drafts from the first phase, and I want to say this is the game where we know the least, where both teams still have kind of options. And that's, you know, this is potentially match points. If VGR win this, they take the match, they qualify for the LAN. And so the pressure's a bit higher, maybe. It's the first game in the series where that was the case, where it was like looming over everyone. And so kind of leads to the two drafters not wanting to commit as all out on what they're doing that early on. VGR do get the phase two bounty hunter, which seems to be becoming a bit of a thing recently, like that bounty hunters slightly lower prioritized after a series of nerfs and there being a lot of heroes that need to be prioritized. It is occasional that the bounty is getting through to the second phase these days.
I like it, though. It's not something that you always have to be that worried about. It's a hero that can be punished if he's taken in the early phase. And, I mean, even taking it second, it's pretty value, but I'd be more worried about a Tidehunter or a Storm Spirit in this situation. But you do have to be careful because there's going to be probably a good amount of kills in this game. And if you think back to that game number two again, where it was the Morphling going up against the Bounty Hunter, I mean, obviously those two were not fighting each other that often, but two heroes that I felt like could have potentially defined the game, VGR really slowed down the pace of it, and there were not a lot of kills, whereas in the previous one, there were 30 kills by 13 minutes. So they've been changing the pace of the game to fit their style, and when there's a Bounty Hunter in it that was against them, they were really slowed down and trying to not make that many kills happen. And now Wings have to play that way as well. They either have to try and go like very heavy aggro, take down towers, or slow down the pace of the game and not give away a lot of that track bounty.
I mean, Wings always want to play aggressively. They really do. They always want to play high tempo. That's I think that's why they GG so early last game, where they realized, like, it's not just that they drafted themselves into a corner. They drafted themselves into a position where they can't take fights. That's, like, that's just not the Wings way. You know, they always want to have some way to make pickoffs or take team fights or do something aggressive in the game. So I certainly think that'll be their plan here. And it is a Dragonite again, second time in a row for VGR. So representing the threat of a push with the DK and Avenge together, even the Lifestealer.
I've got to say, I'm really concerned for Wings already. There's a lot of potential, obviously. You've got the Sunstrike with the Flaming Lasso. You've got Death Ward with Flaming Lasso. But as I'm looking at these VGR heroes, you've got Lifesteal, who can fight incredibly early, as can Dragon Knight. They've got the Bounty Hunter for that acceleration of gold, Vengeful Spirit to force the engagements with Swap. Also, being able to have Roche taking potential on these heroes. I feel like if they want to, they can get very, very aggressive in this game in terms of taking objectives. And I don't know if VGR or if the Wings are really going to be capable of dealing with it. Like, one of the best ways that Witch Doctor brings value to a fight early is through that paralyzing cask. But with a Lifestealer there and a Bounty Hunter who can, you know, either A, rage it off, or B, disjoint it, it causes some issues. But Wingard can go for the Earthshaker.
Earthshaker is a good hero. Haven't seen it yet in the series, but. There's three melee heroes plus a short range hero in Venge, so quite likely to connect your Fissure onto multiple targets when you use it, quite likely to connect your Echo Slam onto multiple targets when you use it, and it's pretty disruptive and controlling when it comes to these fights. And honestly, I think in terms of like run at each other, fight 4v4 with just the four heroes in each draft so far, I would favor Wings. I really think that they have immense control coming out from all of their heroes, and they don't even have their carry yet, so I mean, I know it sounded like you're slanting a bit in favor of VGR and favoring the draft. I don't know. I think the Earthshaker brings it together quite nicely and makes Wings look pretty solid, yeah.
Yeah, I would agree. I granted, that was seeing it before the Earthshaker came out as a pick. The one thing that I would be concerned about, obviously, is getting that Blink Dagger up at a decent time, which if they're fighting a lot and he's able to stay alive, I think he's capable of doing. But I guess the thing that I'd be worried about is if VGR end up coming out ahead in the early stages, if they're able to outplay Wings through the first couple of fights, it becomes a lot harder for them to come back. I don't know if you can come back as easily through, like, when I look at the Wings Gaming's ability to try and come back if they get out to a deficit, it's through finding pickoffs. But I don't think that Vici Gaming Reborn are going to be in a position where they're going to get picked off. It feels like this is a group up and fight style, but they go back for the Lycan now, and I actually really like this pick a lot, except getting the damage up higher with Howl. I feel like this is the way to play it.
We saw this yesterday. We saw the Lycan pick, last pick for Wings against Newbie then, and I think that was a 20-minute win for them at the time. Lycan is a really good pick against Lifestealer because Open Wounds doesn't do anything. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the Lycan can just stand there and fight the Lifestealer, and if at any point in time the Lifestealer is winning, the Lycan could just be like, okay, I'll walk a bit to the left now. You can't do anything. And very interesting, VGR going back for the Lone Druid, because it certainly completes their draft as like we're putting a lot of pressure and pushing, and it's an interesting dynamic in this draft that both teams, after winning a fight, have potential to push down buildings. But I feel like I don't know. I feel like the Lone Druid pick is also a little bit greedy. And it's Lone Druid is going to be the offlane this game. It's a hero that usually gets to its timings no matter what. He's going to have a Midas and a Radiance around 17, 18 minutes probably at the latest. Thing is, Wings will plan to win the game by then already. And the Lone Druid earlier on doesn't actually do that much. And in my opinion, neither does the Bounty Hunter, neither does the Vengeful Spirit. These are heroes that are like... It's not that they don't have impact, but they have one-dimensional impact. They're very limited in what they can do, and I actually think Wings are very, very favored coming out of this draft stage. I think that there's an early window in the game where they've got way more tools available to them to actually take control of the game.
I would agree. I think that I saw the those first four picks there, and I expected to see VGR kind of try and double down on it, and they did in some ways with that Lone Druid as their last pick, but... The problem is Wings are sort of trying to do the same thing but better, and Bounty Hunter, you mentioned, he is a liability, and in the same way, while Lone Druid can provide a lot of damage, he can maybe hit a couple of clutch roots at various points in times, he also doesn't provide a lot in terms of those 5-on-5 engagements pre-Radiance. Now, is there any way to play the Lone Druid without going Midas? Is that just so necessary for the hero, or... Because I feel like if you go Midas Radiance, Wings are going to come so much earlier before you're capable of dealing with it.
You can just go for the Rash Maelstrom and try and fight. Like, it's been done before in the history of Dota. There were a few years ago it was like the thing to do. But I just don't think that's why you pick the hero here. So I'd be shocked if they don't, to be honest. I do expect them to just go the standard build. And that puts me in a position where it's not as bad as last game, but I feel like what I was saying at the start of last game about Wings is Klinks, that I'd have to do a lot of work just coming out of the lane stage to put the team ahead or keep them in the right spot. I think that VGR's Lifesteal is in a similar position this game. The Lifesteal is the hero they have that's going to have a good lane stage, get one or two items, and be very, very strong to contend at those early fights. But it's going to have to, because I think that the other four heroes they have are all kind of one-dimensional in what they do. The Dragon Knight, if it gets the farm, sure to be strong. The Lone Druid, once it gets the farm, will be strong. And the Venge, the Bounty Hunter are, as I keep saying, they're very one-dimensional heroes. They're not versatile in like how they adjust to a fight or any kind of messy interaction that goes on, whereas the entire draft of Wings kind of is.
Having a little bit of trouble loading back into this one. I might need to do it again real quick. I can't tell exactly what's going on. These servers have been kind of struggle bucket central throughout us. We've been able to make it work, but not always the easiest. Have we ended up coming out of the pause as of yet?
Yeah, we have. But creeps haven't spawned yet. We just got people staring down in runes. There's a lichen beating on a spirit bear. but that's... wolf eats bear, apparently. That's how it works.
Oh, come on now.
And one bounty rune per team.
All right, we're here. We've done it. Good stuff. Interestingly enough, it's worth mentioning that the Lone Druid was the last pick. They had 1 second left when they ended up taking it, and it was taken into the Witch Doctor. So not necessarily like the hardest counter in the world, but it is sometimes thought of as an answer to the LD. Fissure dropped out, and that's going to actually keep the Lone Druid Bear stuck in there. They might be able to find this. This would be a really good pickup for them if they're capable of taking it. And a couple of right clicks, maybe going to be able to find him, but he's got... I think that he's dead. Yeah, he pulls him back. That's the resummon. Nicely done.
Yeah. I mean, it's almost just as good. Firstly, he uses the cooldown to resummon. Secondly, I don't know if you noticed, but during the chase, the Witch Doctor just pulled the wave.
Right.
So, okay, good things happening at the bot lane. It is Faith Beyond that goes down first blood, and it seems to be a trend in this matchup that they do manage to kill Faith Beyond the off lane early on almost every game. But look at the pull from Wings. That's what I'm interested in.
I'm trying to. It's still disconnected, sorry.
The Spirit Bear tried to pull the wave away. That's what it's aiming at doing. And instead, the supports on the side of Wings have gotten to farm like two creep camps, essentially. Or at least certainly denied the wave, farmed 1.5 camps. The Bear tried to now pull the wave to the side himself to counteract this, but only going to deny, I think, one of his creeps there.
Well, Yang, I mean, this is always the problem, is trying to figure out how to deal with the Lone Druid in the offlane role, and it looks like they're doing an okay job with it from the start, but not a ton of kill potential as of yet. They're going to bring in that Witch Doctor. There's the catch, and Fissure drops down as well as the Sunstrike. He is going to end up taking a whole lot of damage, and looks like they're going to be able to run him down, possibly TPing out for the moment, and it looks like he's just barely going to be able to get out. Good position in there.
That's fantastically played by Yang. Honestly, that's like, the gank was perfectly executed, and he gets the exact right time on Savage Roar, ran away, used the salve before TPing. Everything exactly right by Yang.
Well, they fought and out the Bounty Hunter, and just one little right click there. Actually going to go under the tower a little bit, trying to get a couple of denies, FY will. And with the DK bottling up the Haster, and there's a little bit of kill potential there, but going to save it for the moment, and yeah, don't want to end up trying to go too far with that. Actually, no, they are going to end up going on him, and he's just going to die. The right clicks come through, and they find the kill, dropping low. They do end up losing FY, and now also Innocence in the area, but the Haster means they're not going to be able to find that kill.
Yeah, we spent a lot of time discussing in the 2 games ago when Wings had the bounty onto themselves, the importance of the battle between the sentry wards and then mid lane, and I believe that at when that fight started, there wasn't a sentry up, so that allows VGR to start things off. There's now a new sentry up for Wings to defend the lane.
And you see up top lane again, the Lone Druid gained a good amount. The other off lane has sort of been relegated to the jungle. Faith Beyond currently doing an okay job of it, but again, it's a pretty tough lane to be a part of. As far as how you see this working out, what's the biggest sort of...
FY comes into the top lane, straight under the sentry ward, and they could try go for this kill here.
Oh, Sunstrike is going to find him, and that's going to be a dead hero. Yeah, Maledict is really proven to be a big boon for them here in this top lane, is taking it at the level 2.
Yep. But it's the sentry ward doing work. They were prepared. It's the first time he's come into the lane, and they just saw him straight along. And now he goes back to the mid lane, but there's a sentry here now too. It's not going to spot him just yet. And it's important that the Invoker plays around where the sentry is to get the vision at the right time. They sees the bounty enter. Time to go back.
And just right-click FY a couple times. Get out of here. We don't want none of your shenanigans. That is going to signal to FY that there is going to be a sentry ward in the area.
Yeah, and he's going to try guess and find it with his now. And let's see if he puts it in the right spot.
Yang ends up denying the Invis rune. Nicely played. That was a fissure block.
I think FY's gonna... Whoa. Gets chased away by the Invoker. He's this is what he's looking for. He's looking for a time to place his sentry and see if he can find the enemy, but he's pinged it. He knows exactly where it is now. He's figured it out. And that's kind of cool because he approached from 2 different angles and could be seen in both times. He kind of guessed, well, that's where it must be. But we've got a new sentry actually on the other side now for Wings as well. So even if FY found that sentry, it'd still be one to spot him out.
And it looks like it's just a little bit too far away from being able to get dewarded by both of them. They did find Innocence again. FY going to run him down. Orb of Venom and Boots level 3. But not going to be able to do it. And he places one where it's not quite going to be able to spot out the other sentry ward that's there. So fine for the moment, as we do have, again, End and... And DDC down here in the bottom lane, just trying to apply a little bit more pressure. God, the frame rate is so terrible right here on this server. I'm not sure exactly what's going on. They get the courier kill. FY takes that one down, but nothing on it.
Yeah, it's still a courier kill. Pretty good value. He's getting a lot done, actually, FY. He's getting levels. He's getting involved. Doing a good job on this bounty hunter, despite the fact that Wings have been extremely vigilant about dealing with him.
Well... Again, Wings mid lane takes a little bit of a breathe fire damage, and Nono having a good time here. 40-6 versus the 29-6 of the Invoker. So his mid lane's been pretty effective.
It's the bounty hunter effect, yeah. I think. Certainly made a big difference.
Oh my god, I'm going to try one more disconnect. This is disastrous. I'm sorry, everybody out there. We're going to try and make this work, though.
And FY could be in danger again here. Thought they spotted him. They do have a sentry, but yeah, killed the ward, so now FY knows for sure. Okay, there's a sentry around there somewhere. Interestingly, FY has started with the infused raindrops early on in this game. It's an item we've seen become more and more popular, although I haven't seen it on bounty hunter before this game.
Well, looks like we're coming back into it now. Again, apologize. Try and make this the best possible viewing experience that we can, but a little bit of issues. Now we're back into it. So, top lane, a little bit of a battle of Bruin as Innocence and Ice are here. FY is going to be able to spot them all out, though, so not going to end up diving for it. They've already taken the tier 1 tower in the bottom lane. VGR are just, they are continuing to push.
Yep, going for the tier 2 now. At the moment, it's not mattering that they have a lone druid that doesn't really do anything in the game just yet, because the other heroes are doing enough to apply the pressure, and that's very good for them.
Oh, top lane. Ice Ice maybe going to end up going down here as they've got him in the area, but the TPs have already come in. They're going to pull back. No, dropping low. He is going to die. And Wings punish the overextension. It does look like FY was able to find the kill on the Urshig. Actually, got denied by the little small camp. Man, that was value right there.
So it's very unlucky for FY. It would have been a pretty valuable kill if he got it. Also, really important that Wings come in and reinforce that bot lane, because they, as I was saying all along and during the draft, I feel like Wings are the team that want to be applying this early kind of pressure. And when you let the other team go tier 1 and tier 2, that's really damaging in terms of the lead that they get, the gold advantage. So Wings recognizing, you know, this is a point at which we need to put a stop sign up and say they can't just take all our towers.
Well, now maybe going to think about trying to move into the jungle. They've got DDC and End here, but a lot of heroes in the mid lane for Wings, and they're going to head up the ramp. Innocence, the first one to spot him. They do have Rage available, and they end up throwing out the open wounds. He's going to drop so quickly. FY is there, and it's a little bit of that experience as well. So a nice little start for them the whole time through, though. Lone Druid also pushing the top tower, and they should be able to take this one without question. No-No takes a lot of damage onto the mid tower, too.
Yeah, so this is going to be one of the games where Wings, again, their battle rider won't go drum. He's going to rush the blink. It's super important that they get the timing on that blink very, very soon, next couple of minutes, because that's the real item that they need to enable them to turn the momentum around and be the ones that are the aggressors. Right now, VGR are getting away with being the aggressor team, despite the fact that they're the ones with the lone druid, and that's kind of awkward for Wings. That's a dynamic that needs to change sometime soon, or they're going to be in a lot of trouble in this game. And it's mostly because the lifesteal has been so involved. I mean, this is a lifesteal that's been pushing towers, going for ganks, going for kills. He doesn't even have his armlet yet. Just the phase boots and the blightstone, but he's been everywhere. And he's kind of the implicit threat. When he's involved in a push or fights or something, it's just difficult for Wings to be like, oh, we'll just go and take them on.
And now, he's speaking about it, he's got his Blightstone up, just going to try and farm up in the mid lane again, and you do have Wings who's taking a tower of their own, so this is the power that the Lycan gives you, is Vlad's up, he can start to push each of these lanes out, they're going to move into Roshan and try and take this one down, and I'm not sure if VGR realize that this is happening, or if they're really capable of doing much to stop it, but the mid-tier one should probably fall in response. Oh my god, and we've got some interesting Dragonites on the field now as well. Not sure if you've got the same bug that I do, but Roshan falling, this should end up being the tier 1 tower for it.
Yep. Batrider also finishes Blink, though. So this is kind of, this is going to be a key window for Wings. This is going to be, Wings sort of expect to get a big lead in the next 10 minutes, I think. And we'll have to see if they can. That's really the big deal. Lifesteal has infested a dire creep, and he's controlling it, running around.
Oh, they jump in, they pull back Yang. He's in a lot of trouble, but they've already taken down the tier 1 tower. Faith Beyond is going to end up being able to help out to find that kill. Lycan is the one that gets the last hit onto the lone druid, who just finished off his Hand of Midas. So he did at least hit that timing, but maybe this is the point that Wings were looking for, where they're avoiding fights early, and now they're going to be able to take the tier 1 here in the mid lane.
Yeah, this is exactly the timing. This is like perfect start to what's meant to be a favorable timing for them. Although I think there is going to be an attempt here from VGR to fight. Lifesteal is invisible in the back lines. And
oh, jumps on the trouble. Faith Beyond. Lots of damage coming out. They do have No-No there, who throws out the Breathe Fire, also bringing down the Batrider at the start. They're all very tanky, and Shadow trying to bring them down. There's also going to be the Echo Slam. Everything committed onto No-No, and he does finally fall. The Dragon Knight gets taken down. So a 2-for-1 exchange. And they didn't save their tier 1 tower either.
It's good from Wings to not panic about the fact that, oh, there's an invisible lifesteal on our bat, what do we do? Because they couldn't do anything about it. The bat is just dead, they can't help it. They focus their attention on the other side of the fight. They're like, okay, we've got a Bounty Hunter under True Sight, we're going to kill him. Hey, look, we can catch the Dragonite too. It's possible under those circumstances when the lifesteal suddenly appears out of invis, the enemy seems all seeping in, for you to panic a bit and end up losing that fight, but it's kind of Wings' element when they're in those early fights. They're in a good timing. They kind of know that they are, and they really like these early sort of fast-paced fights.
And I feel like, again, it's sort of, it almost seems though that both teams are fairly comfortable taking these types of engagements. I mean, we saw the early pushing power already out of VGR, and they've taken all of the Tier 1 towers and are also invading the jungle right now of Wings, but, I mean, Wings are doing the exact same thing. Is there one side that is going to scale better into the mid-game? I'm concerned that we're not really seeing, like, enough dominance yet out of Wings, considering it's going to be a lone druid with a Midas and eventually a Radiance.
Yeah, well, that's the eventually is key there, because okay. It's... Up until the point that he gets the Radiance, I think Wings are still kind of favored. Once he gets the Radiance, that's where the turning point is supposed to happen. But he's going to die now, I think. So
they jump onto him. Yeah, you're right. And, well, okay, they decide not to. The Savage Roar is going to be able to keep them back for the moment. Needs to go into true form. The rest of his team is going to end up TPing in and trying to take this one. The Magic Missile goes out, and they're not able to find that kill.
Mis-executed, actually, just by Wings. They needed to make sure Witch Doctor got the stun off first, and then they almost certainly get the kill, but Lycan runs in a bit ahead of the Witch Doctor, and as a result, they can't get the kill. And Wings are looking for a ward on the cliff here, which there was a ward previously, and it's timed out. And too bad they look for Oni now.
That's a little bit frustrating for them, and...
Yeah, again. Dragon Knight, Blink Dagger with Lifesteal infested in him, and if they find Faith Bian, he's definitely dead.
Does Faith Beyond want to jump out on No-No? It'd be a pretty bold play for them to do it. It does look like that's going to happen. They've got FY here, and I'll see what they end up doing. They do jump on a No-No. There's going to be Lifestealer going out. They've got the Fissure from afar and going to be able to possibly bring him down. Dragon Tail ends up getting dropped, and the Echo Slam also, it's not quite enough damage. They do kill off No-No and needs to get out of here. ZYF getting ran down. Cold Snap as well as that Aftershock. Oh, Silence coming out. I think that he's going to be able to walk away. Yeah, they're still fine for the moment. Pretty well played there by Wings to find the kill, though.
Yeah, and again, it's another situation where the important part is that they don't panic when they realize that it is a trap. They definitely didn't expect Lifestealer to be inside Dragon Knight. And in fact, all the information was on the side of VGR, because FY had scouted the other heroes coming in. And I think VGR maybe overestimated the importance of like the fact that they had set up this trap. Like, oh, surely if Bat goes on, I'll DK now. Because Lifestealer's inside, that'll just be that. But it wasn't enough. Oh.
And FY gets caught. He tried to go for a little bit of the sneaky play. He tracked and then afterwards went for the shark and buys back now. They realize they need to be able to defend this one. It's such a key moment right here. And Lone Druid still has his TP. Hasn't adapted to come on back as of yet. DDC stunned. They have the rage out for end and gonna pull back DDC. The Witch Doctor ulti comes out as well. Vengeful Spirit is just dead. They knew that that's the one they needed to go on, so they didn't end up being able to break it. Tracked up. Shadow taking damage. Not dead as of yet and dropping lower. They might think about going in on this. Again, Open Wound's not going to impact that, but it does look like they're still maybe going to be able to get a trade for the Tier 1 and the Tier 2 in the top lane, trying to find the kill. Can they kill off Shadow? It'd be pretty big if they could, but again, the Aegis, it's already down. Oh, that would have been such a big moment, but they couldn't find it.
Yeah, so something really great about this series, by the way, both these teams, if we look at all of the games, they're so aware of when there's a window to just suddenly go high ground, even when it's very early in the game, and it's really nice to see top level Dota.
Absolutely. Bear is not going to get taken down at this point in time. They might try and go for the poof in a second. Yang, still alive. They actually do end up bringing that bear down. So he dies, but they do have the resummon as well, and only 600 gold away from finishing off that relic. When they have the Radiance on this bear, we talked a lot about the Alchemist not really being able to fight even when he had it up. Is that not the case for Lone Druid? Is he going to be able to actually provide something to the team fights?
Yeah, it's different. Alchemist buys Radiance to farm. Lone Druid buys Radiance to fight. He definitely can fight with it. The concern that I have is that the items are looking so good for Wings. I mean, this Earthshaker, I don't think this blink is vital, but he's going to have a blink, and it's a huge luxury for his team. And it's maybe bigger for dealing with that early fight than the Radiance on the Lone Druid, to be honest. So, I don't know. Look, we've already seen one game in the series where Wings had the advantage early on, applied a lot of pressure, and then the Morphling got too big and ended up beating them. But I'm not convinced that a Lone Druid is Morphling status. I feel like the turning point in this game for VGR has to be actually succeeding in some of these fights.
Now they jump on in, are going to be able to pull back the Lifestealer, taking a lot of damage, trying to turn on the Ice, and they actually are going to be able to do a lot of damage there. The Lifestealer ends up killing him off, infests inside, and ends up being able to jump out. Innocence falls. That's two dead, but they are still taking a tower in the top lane. They end up popping the glyph. That was a big play.
It's a costly, mis-execution by Wings, I want to say. They should kill the lifesteal there. If they just wait a bit, the Earthshaker could have gotten there sooner. They could have chained the disable. Vantage wasn't there. It's not like the lasso got broken by a swap. So I think with the Sunstrike, if they chain the Earthshaker, the Batrider, and the Witch Doctor ulti going all along, they're going to kill Lifestealer. But they didn't manage to get the chain disable between the Bat and the Earthshaker because they were just in a bit too much of a rush, actually, with the initiation. And they give away two cheap deaths for no reason at all, really.
And now starting to build into their next items as well. Nono just finished off one of those Necro books, killed it, and that's a nice little chunk of gold going his way. 2,800. Is it just the armlet at this point for the Dragonite? You've already got it in the Echo Saber on the Lifestealer. It feels like that's probably the pickup.
It seems like the most standard pickup in this situation, but he might want something bigger. He might want, like, for instance, a BKB, recognizing that he can be more kind of the rock in the fight and go for a right now build. Rather, you know, let the Lifestealer and the Lone Druid do the scaling. Because if he doesn't have a BKB, he could just be going down to all that spillover magic damage. Speaking of magic damage, there's going to be a Sunstrike kill for Invoker on Bounty Hunter.
Well, pretty well played there. Picks up one easy one, and it looks like it's time to try and think about this other tier 2 in the mid lane. Again, Roshan not back up for a couple of minutes here, and they're just holding out as long as possible. You're very close to picking up the Radiance on the Lone Druid, and if they can finish up another little bit of creep wave here, maybe you can get back and actually fight in this team fight. But again, you talked about it, eventually having to go up against that Earthshaker Blink, it could be really detrimental.
Yep. Wings have all their ultis up right now. Probably looking to just keep pushing while the Necro is lost. When the Necros run out, they might stop, but
yeah, tracking up
give the house all the summons, and I mean, look at this tower. It's going down just to a bunch of summons with the Lycanhal.
God, that's
I think
so
Wings
scary.
Will be fine with that for now.
Well, yeah, and the Radiance comes out from the bear, so they're going to disengage for the moment, but you know, a key item picked up. You do need to be careful on this again for the Wings. We talk about him not being as strong as the Morphling, and that's obviously he's not going to be able to carry a team fight in the same way, but you do end up losing maybe just one team fight, and he's going to rip through your base pretty much as quick as can be, particularly with that DK in hand and all the other stuff. But time to go on in and fight around the Roche Pit. Oh my god, the Invoker actually is going to have an Aghanim Scepter in a couple of minutes here.
Yeah, this is, I mean, it's still the case that if VGR turn the corner in this game, the game will be very hard for Wings to win. If VGR gets to the point where, like, all their heroes are scaling and it's going later. But it's not the same as the Morphling game in the sense that they need to win fights to get there. They can't, like, just, with the Morphling plan, you're just stalling, avoiding fights, and getting farm, and once Morphling gets the right items, you're fine. I don't think that's the case here for VGR. I think that it's going to be a necessary component that they succeed in holding a few fights or even winning a few fights.
Oh, and here's the smoke now that comes out from Wings. God, VGR just checked the Roche Pit, and it does respawn as that comes out. So a little bit unlucky for the side of VGR, but Wings are going to be able to pick this up rather quickly, I would imagine. Also, a haste rune up for Faith Beyond. Man, this is just like the perfect combination of events right here. And if they're able to combo this all together perfectly, I'd be really worried about it. VGR... Faith Beyond doesn't have any reveal, so the smoke breaks, but haste rune picked up. Yeah, that should be about it. They're going to move in. Try and see if they can do this. The bear is in the pit with them, and they actually end up force-stepping it up to the high ground, so they end up being able to take down Roshan. Meanwhile, a lot of damage going out. The Yule Scepter lifts up the Invoker. They're doing a good amount to him, and he's dropping so low, he is going to end up falling. The Lone Druid Radiance was enough to kill him off, and already a huge pickoff for them. Nono trying to chase down Faith Beyond, not going to be able to get it quite yet, but Ice instead is going to be the one that they turn on to, and trying to find that kill. It does look like they might be able to do as they spot him out. There's going to be the Dragon Tail, a couple of right clicks, and even though the Fissure is going to come out, I think he is still going to fall as the Wave of Terror, the one more from Nono, and that is a really big series of events right there for VGR.
Yeah, even though we said that, even though the Lycan gets the Aegis, even though the Dioside kill the Rush, it's still a good fight for VGR. It's the kind of fight they need, and you know, we talk about forcing the Spirit Bear out, and obviously the Spirit Bear was being a nuisance, maybe going to try last hits, or just give the vision for the initiation, or get in the way of picking up the Aegis. I feel like if you save the 4-star for the Invoker, maybe you win the fight as Wings. Yeah. But Invoker just gets bursted down and can't do anything. He I don't think he cast any spells except Ghostwalk in that entire fight. He was in a position that was awkward and nobody could save him.
Well, and now you're also starting to get into a couple of these other of these big items. You've got the BKB completed for Nono, you have a Desolator on the lone or on the Life Sealer, as well as the Echo Saber. This is a pretty scary moment right here, as Invoker ends up being able to kill off the Bounty Hunter in the mid lane. A little bit of a misstep there for FY.
Yeah, we're still... I mean, it's a strange place for the game to be in. We're still in a spot where, in the next couple of minutes, Wings could just get a Rax, I think.
Yeah.
But it feels like there's more tension, there's more pressure. They're not as comfortable as they were a little while back. But they definitely have the tools to win a fight, and they certainly have the tools to kill buildings if they do. Oh, you know, we haven't seen that big blink echo yet. We haven't seen the catastrophic pickoff from the bat. And it's actually going to be VGR smoking, looking for the initiation themselves.
Oh, this is really scary. Ice on the other side. Nono might be the one that finds them. They're going to end up breaking the smoke on him. And yeah, that's the quick blink away, realizing that something could have gone wrong there. They back out for the moment. The lone druid bear is there, but yeah, they're going to call off the charge.
Yeah, they've got creeps in the base on both other sides, so they know what's going on, Wings do, and if they can wait off the DK ulti, it'll be really good for them to fight after the DK ulti's finished. And that's kind of why you see the DK scouting around. I mean, they don't have wasted his ulti, and even the lifesteal ulti for nothing. But there's creeps killing the bot racks, and they kill the bot racks. There's only a ranged rax, so not really a priority. The tier 2 at the top lane is almost certainly just going to be dropped now that the Dragonite ulti and Lifesteal ulti have been wasted. And the question will be if Wings decide it's worth going for the high ground while the DK ulti is still down. I think it very well might be. I don't know if they get a better window than this.
Yeah, and if they could come on in here and take a second set of barracks, that's pretty much as close to game as it can get without actually calling it. It would be a really devastating blow for VGR. We'll see if they're capable of doing it. Again, another very quick one by all accounts if this is going to end up being another high ground, as you have Faith Beyond there looking for an initiation. Nono is going to get spotted. They still have not popped the BKB for him as of yet, so a lot of fighting potential on the side of VGR. Shadow going to be
very
tracked.
Early fortification used, so... Almost forces Wings to commit something, at least all the summons, just to Talia with the fortification being used that early on. But they're not actually going to achieve much here. They haven't even damaged the Talia. They did a little bit of damage to the Observer Ward that's on the high ground. They're extremely defensively placed.
Just ensuring that their retreat's going to come about. You do again have the track on Shadow, and we talked about the need to try and sort of slow down the tempo of the game, and that is what Wings have done, so that this Bounty Hunter hasn't been able to get out of control with picking up track kills and such. So I like what we're seeing so far. He is going to be building towards that mechanism and should be able to get it relatively shortly. But the AC on Lycan at 25 minutes on top of Necrobook 3 and that Vlad's, this is a really big pickup here as well.
Yeah. The biggest pickup coming out for a VGR student is actually DDC Vengeful Spirits. He's got level 11, so he's got level 2 ulti, and he's very close to buying a... Aether Lens, that's the item. I just completely lost the words for a second. And I think level 2 Venge ulti with the Aether Lens makes it near impossible to initiate with Bat ulti, unless you're on the Venge itself. Because wherever it is in the fight, it's going to be able to immediately swap and cancel that ulti, and... That's a huge loss for Wings if they try to stall the battle ulti and it gets countered immediately.
Well, Shadow now. The Aegis has just ended up expiring, and again, you do have the split push that's still going on. Apparently it's called Lovely Panda. I didn't realize that was a name that you got on your spirit bear. That's pretty cool. Like,
you can name them. I mean, it's...
I don't play
it's
this
It's like
here,
an
yeah.
engraving.
That's pretty cool.
He decided. Yeah.
The Force Staff now up on... Or not up, but being built towards for the Earthshaker too. Just whatever mobility they can possibly find. And you can see that the Tri-Core for VGR as they go later is going to be really difficult to deal with. But I do feel like the heroes for Wings scale great into the late game regardless of that. I mean, Earthshaker late game is just a juggernaut. You've got the Witch Doctor who's capable of dealing a ton of damage as well.
Wait, are you saying in the late game Earthshaker becomes a juggernaut?
Yeah, that's
that's new. that would be interesting. I get what you're saying though. Yeah, it's they're not, Wings are not like bad in the late game.
Yeah,
I do think that it's a little bit favorable for VGR the later it goes, with their carrying potential, their scaling potential. What's going to be good for Wings is that the rush is actually a reasonably fast respawn this time. I think it was like an 8.5 minute one. So it's not going to be too long until the next rush is up. And if they do get that under their belt, it will give them another opportunity to try break the high ground. And it's again going to be that situation where VGR are going to have to decide, do we contest the rush or do we rather just try to defend the high ground against the Aegis?
And it's a tough decision indeed. Invoker, by the way, is about to have his Lincolns flown out to him. So another big pickup there. They're not going to be able to get that initiation off with the Venge swap, but probably going to have to save it for the Batrider counter initiation to make sure that whoever it is that ends up getting jumped on is not going to be the one that's getting taken immediately out of the fight. I mean, again, for VGR, it feels like it's just been the story so far of all of this. Oh, ends up being able to get the Savage Roar, interrupting the TP of Innocence, and now it's going to get ran down. They got a lot of heroes that are going to be catching up to him and trying to survive through it, but no jumps. They find the kill. That's going to be a little one going their way. Was that a track kill, though?
No.
FY is in mid lane. A little unfortunate.
There's something kind of comedic about Lovely Panda using Savage Roar, but... Witch Doctor thought it was a friendly panda. He doesn't need to be afraid of it. And turned out he was, what? Okay, they're going to punish this bear.
They've got FY in the area, though, and now already throwing out the track. They have a lot of heroes here. FY backs. Again, if they wanted to try and take this, they definitely could. They pop the ulti form for the Lycan and just decide to run away. That was actually the Elder Dragon form used as well. So a little bit unfortunate that they weren't able to find anything more with that.
Targeting the Spirit Bear is a really smart plan in this game, actually. If you ever kill it twice so it doesn't have resummon, that's definitely an opportunity to go high ground. And Venge, unless it gets to Axe, it can't actually swap the Spirit Bear, I believe. I mean, it's not a hero, so...
Right.
That's... You can't stop the... It's something that came up quite a bit at the Shanghai Major. There was an important game where Alliance beat EHOME, knocked them out of the tournament, and that depended a lot on them using the bat to keep catching the Spirit Bear. There were also some important games where teams lost out trying to do the same thing. It's a bit risky if you commit your bad initiation to the Spirit Bear and you don't actually kill it, and suddenly you've used your battles, you've used your initiation card, and they turn around and fight you.
Well, it looks like now they want to try and push down lanes themselves. As VGR on the aggressive, they pop the Rage. Desolator is lowering down that armor, and you've also got the Bear there. They end up being able to jump in. Faith Beyond a little bit of trouble. A lot of damage coming out. No jumps in on the back line. The Meteor is already dropped, and with Vengeful Spirit dead, I feel like this is already favoring Wings a lot. They get out with one, and looks like they're going to be able to escape with pretty much everybody else. And the Tier 2 tower stands.
Yeah, so... I don't know if that was a mistake or intentional, but Faith Beyond blinked in long before he had Lasso. He still had like 4 seconds before cooling down on it. And it seemed like VGR panicked. And like, you know, the Venge was expecting to swap defense. Well, they're actually catching the Lone Druid here. I mean, his Spirit Bear is dead anyway, so he's not even that important at this point.
This is a huge pickoff, though, again, because you still don't want to have to... I mean, he doesn't have buyback, and he could have had a resummon back up in 8 seconds. This is really unfortunate.
But this the start of the fight in the mid lane was so bad for VGR. Like, I think the Venge was so instinctively expecting that when Bat jumps in, I'm going to swap someone. The Bat doesn't lasso anyone, so he swaps the Bat and then gets himself in a terrible position. The fight just starts poorly for them.
Well, they jump onto the Invoker, force staffing him away for the moment, but he is going to end up falling in a second. That's the Yule Scepter lifting him up. They reapply the track. They find the kill, swapping on back. Faith Beyond, suddenly 4 and 5, they're going to be able to do it, but the counter initiation with the Echo Slam is immense. DDC is going to end up falling from that. The Lone Druid is already dead, and they're bringing them all down solo. Innocence, though, is going to fall, and it looks like with that, the DK dead, and soon to be as well that FY Bounty Hunter. Oh, wow.
It's kind of hilarious because the Lycan, if you watch Shadow, he was like leaving. He gave up on it. He was like, okay, my Invoker died. What a noob. Earthshaker suddenly blinks in and catches everyone, and it's like a brilliant fight for his team, and Lycan like slowly waddles back to the fight. So I'm not sure if Wings were all on the same page there. It's certainly costing them when Invoker dies. It's happened a few times. Like when Invoker gets caught in the front and just gets killed, it really is costly. And if you consider the fact that Lycan has 0 deaths this game, you can imagine him being like, oh man, if my Invoker can just stay alive, we can sustain these pushes. So Invoker dies, they start retreating, but then the incredible Earthshaker play, finding that opening, they still get a Rax from it, and now Rush is alive, so it's going to be a Rush, which I don't think can be contested either.
This is really important right here, and again, the TP boots in. They've got him up and ready to go for Invoker, and this is going to be Roshan going their way. Again, the lineup of EGR just not capable of taking these fights the way that they need them to. And, you know, you're building into these bigger items right here on the Lone Druid, but they're just not up quickly enough. They've got the Vlads and a Hyperstone, but no AC as of yet. They've got one on the Lycan. Meanwhile, Aetherlens is completed for the Venge and level 2 ulti, but it's just, it doesn't feel like they're getting enough out of these fights. They're not finding the kills that would give them the acceleration outside of that Invoker, but with the Earthshaker just making those big plays, it's a huge problem.
Yeah, that, and this is the important difference between these drafts, right, is that VGR, their carry potential definitely does outscale Wings, but it's not all about carry potential. It's also about control and utility. Often these fights are decided on that, and there's very little of that on the side of VGR. You know, they've got, what are the tools in their toolbox? They've got Dragonite can blink and stun someone, they've got a Swap and a Stun and a Savage Roar, whereas every hero on Wings is like two or three different spells to control people in a fight.
Oh, well, they pop in the ulti. They're going to jump on Innocence. Earthshaker is going to be able to walk back over here if they want to try and take this fight. No controlled. Lifting up in the tornado, and they're going to end up backing out for the moment. Fissure drops onto FY. They're going to pull back another one. Echo Slam solo onto DDC, and it looks like with that end is going to need to try and get out of here. Yang is so low, and they are going to end up being able to kill him off in just a second, I believe, possibly. Trying to swap him out. They are going to be able to do a lot of damage. They bring him down. Another core dead. Lifestealer is away, but man, this is just so hard to imagine them coming back at this point.
Yeah, this feels like we're going to game 5. I mean, it's honestly, that's the thing. VGR, it really is a weakness of their draft that they have this initial initiation. They do their things, and then what after that? It's not, on the side of Wings, it's totally different. There's so many different tools to disable, to stun, to move people around, displace. They've always got more coming.
Yeah, buyback there. No wants to fight a little bit more. Lifestealer is not quite up to it as of yet. They're going to buy back another, trying to find this FY, doing what he can, but it's not nearly enough. And No chases down, fissured up, is going to fall in, and is going to run onto Ice, but I don't think that they have enough damage to bring down the rest of the side of Wings. As of yet, they jump out, and that's going to be the Lifestealer ult to use. They pull him back. DDC is going to be able to swap him away for the moment, but GG finally does get called by FY, and we are going to be going to a game number 5 here in the China qualifiers. It's felt at various points like it could have gone either way, and suddenly, magically, the lag is gone. I don't know. What do you expect in here? Game number 5.
I think it's kind of fitting at the end of the game, Lifestealer and Lycan were both 8-0, and then Lycan just kills him and gets his godlike, says, "This is my game, not yours." The Lifestealer did a lot this game. It was difficult to control, but ultimately, I do think that we see, certainly with the way the game went, that Wings did have a draft advantage again this game. And it does feel like regularly when Wings do win, they have a big draft advantage. Some of the times when they lose, like the game before this one, they have a pretty big draft disadvantage of their own doing. I think VGR won't go for the Lone Druid again. Or if they do, they need to go for a slightly different... I just think that their draft is too one-dimensional. It's very good at doing what it does. If it gets ahead, then they're just going to push down all your lanes. There's nothing you can do. But it doesn't have enough tools to get ahead. It doesn't have enough tools to react or be versatile, adapt to the situation. And I expect that they'd try and go for something more rounded, more versatile, going into the final game of the series. And I don't know. The draft is so important. The draft is everything. It could be, depending on the draft, it could be like 90-10 Wings favored, 90-10 VGR favored, or it could be very close. It's really, really big in this game 5.
All right, well, we'll see in just a little bit. Again, China qualifiers. This is going to be the last game, one game to decide who it is that's going to move on to LA, and I can't wait to see what ends up happening. The Wings Gaming facing off against Vici Gaming Reborn. Stick around, everybody. We'll be right back in just a little bit.